message on this. Okay, all right, so some of this should actually be, let's try to call this to, okay, so in case we get a text message on this. Okay, we're still going. All right. So this is just to go over some of the basic, some of the basics of the UCC, and go over some matters that we discussed already. This is for the Conquering Line, the Tribe of Judah Mission Incorporated, A.K.A. the Line of Judah Society, and I am Rasi Adinos Tassari, one of the co-founders of this society. Wyndham Yadu. And now I'm looking at the UCC, the present version. There's a couple places to be updated on it, namely under the attention, under the authorization, where it says all disciples, members, units should be inserted between members and bands. It says bands, officers, ambassadors, and ministers of the Society of His Imperial Majesty, otherwise known as the LOJ, the Line of Judah, Yehuda Moa Andesa Machidr or Mazini. Now, regarding the UCC Universal Church or Churchical Code, this is our updated bylaws or the order of official business. It's from the Executive Ministry, HSI, Haile Selassie, First Board of Directors, and from I, His Highness Rasi Adinos Tefari. Now, our standing bylaws. Now, we'll explain the seven functional positions, disciples, members, next, units, bands, officers, ambassadors, and ministers. What's the role and responsibility? I didn't mention this, but originally it was promulgated April 21st, 1997, and was updated. This update I'm reading from is May 27th, 2012, concerning the Rastafari Church, or the Beta Rastafari, and our UCC, Universal Churchical Code. Standing bylaws, official order of business. The authorization reads, by authority of our Black Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, Jesus Christos, to the glory of our Godfather, the Conquering Line, the Tribe of Judah, His Imperial Majesty, Haile Selassie, Ketamawi Haile Selassie, or Haile Selassie I, the elect of God, King of Kings of Ethiopia, based upon the Holy Bible, the Book of the Seven Seals, known to us as the Metzhaf Kedus, and also recognized and sanctioned under international law since 1948 by Article 18 and Article 28 of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, UDHR. Now, let's get into just some basics here. We was explaining previously that the unit, the threefold cord, as Ecclesiastes speak of, is what we call a three-man unit. And when we say man, we're speaking generically. It could be three sisters or brothers or three mothers, in other words. But the qualification for brotherhood and sisterhood is the words of Jesus Christos when he says, who is my brother? And the key is the will of the Father. All right. Now, this is the ideal, the unit, three-man unit is the ideal. Right? The three-man unit is the ideal. Firstly, the chairperson or the chairman, the Lika member, or the president, it also can be called president. In other words, there's other names for these positions, you understand, in the three-man unit, but how we are utilizing it is as chair, the chairperson, Lika member, but it might be a president in another three-man sort of a unit. Secondarily is the co-chair, the co-chair, which would be a vice president, the vice president. Now, the function of a chair and a vice president is interesting, and we will explain that. Actually, in line of Judah, I'm the co-chair, actually. But I function in the role of the chair. But the chair, of course, is Abba, is Yeshua. He is the chair. So he reigns in I heart, and he's supposed to reign in our heart, in our heart chakra. So the three-man unit, let's go over this again. This would be the executive, otherwise known as the executive, or in this age of digital and computer technology, the executionable program. Once you have that threefold cord or that trinity, the chair, the co-chair, and thirdly is the secretary. Or in some organizations, it would be a secretariat. What's the difference between a secretary, in other words, and a secretariat? Well, a secretariat would be an office, basically, where there would be secretaries or scribes, recorders, or those who are taking care of the paperwork or the business, the files, the archives. On that sort of a level is the secretariat, which would have a main secretary. And we'll get into them hard titles as we go further and forward. The first thing to understand the basic structure and the operation. So we have the chair, the co-chair, and the secretary, right? Secretary can be called a scribe or recorder. Even King David and King Solomon, they had a very organized unit, although David only had the Shalosha or the 30, the Salasa. They were mighty men, but they also were men of the pen as well, or the quill, if you please, right? Or the Tehuti writing instrument. So the executionable program is when you have this three-man ideal in spirit and in truth, in the true faith. You know, so the faith is the qualifier right there. The faith is the key element, that faith, that trust, the trust factor. You understand? And therefore, if one says the Shema and their words and their works do follow, I receive them. Trust but verify. Or really trust and verify. Former President of the United States said trust but verify. We say trust and. That's the key difference. And verify. Because that trust but verify is a whole different logic of word if you go into it. But let's go over this right here so that those who we are inviting can understand how this works, since ones do have certain questions on it. It may seem like a bit much. It may seem somewhat legal, but it's basically operational. So we have the three-man unit. Now you can visualize a three-man unit as a trinity or as a pyramid. All right? So in, using a visual representation, a symbolical representation, it's a pyramid or a trinity, a triangle, or the salutation of the Salamta of Shalom of Kedamawi Haile Selassie of our Godfather Abba, which is the Trinity hands, which have been so misunderstood by many in the world, and even many of us are learning and growing and understanding. So we have that Trinity, right? Those three, the chair, the co-chair, and the secretary is how we will qualify it in basic churchical and churchical related operations. But once the one understand this system, you understand and apply it, it has a multi purpose application. So it's also a gift, understanding these things. You understand they will improve one's business in the private sector or in the public. And that reminds I and I of the teaching of His Majesty on the Constitution. And let's see if we can get this. We might do another vid or audio. This is going to be in an audio form. And we beg you take a listen to it, my brothers and sisters. And I have questions as well. have questions as well. We look forward to the questions. Some people don't look forward to it, so a lot of our people feel way about asking questions or think that their questions are silly or ones making. We don't see it like that. We might have missed something. You know what I'm saying? We might have overlooked something that we thought to put in, but due to the flesh, not the spirit, being weak. You know what I'm saying? Due to the flesh being weak, we avoid it or we did not put it in. All right, so 192 of the autobiography of His Majesty, Hiwetenaya Ethiopia Erimja. 192 is the page in the English, and it's 159 for those who might be looking into this in the Amharic. And let's first of all just go over the meaning of law, right? And this is from His Majesty's autobiography, and it says that the meaning of law is the obligation of government to define every contract, every agreement, right? Made or covenant, we can say, a contract, an agreement, or a covenant made between men. A kal, a word, kidan, agreement or covenant, that word that covers this or that or the next matter. So that security and peace be created for the conditions of life in the world. For the conditions of our Christian, our Rastafari Hewitt, our life in this world. We're in the world, but we're not of the world. Now, the meaning of law is also that it should hold responsible any man transgressing a contractual obligation and hand him over to the powers possessing the responsibility of enforcement. That's the judges, the shofetim, the farajoch. All right, if we do not regulate ourselves, we leave the Gentiles no option. And let's understand that. This is the basic reality. This being so, it goes on to say, law provides for man a distinct definition of what is permitted to him so that he may fully benefit from it. Furthermore, the law, while warning man of the duties incumbent upon him, orders him to fulfill his obligations. Anything that is permitted to man to benefit by is called the right of exercise of enjoyment. Please take note. The right of exercise of enjoyment. This right of enjoyment, joy, and right, and we may have joy, right? But this right of enjoyment is divided into two main parts. So before we go on into the UCC, you'll send our universal LOJ-UCC, it's important for us to understand what His Majesty says and what is said in His Majesty's autobiography at this point right here. Very, very important. So we understand this, that one, firstly, there's private privileges. Right? The your one's faith is a personal thing, but the country is for all. But we once have to understand the role that one's faith plays in building trust among brothers and sisters and working together. You understand? In that which is churchical, building the groundation, the foundation, as well as in business. You understand? This is our birthright. You understand? So the private privileges are those which are for each person in his individual capacity, in his individual capacity. His Majesty's impermanence says that, you know, the material and the spiritual must be balanced. Now, the religion, when we say religion, we're saying religion is the outer shell in the Western Gentile misinterpretations, the outer shell. This gives I and I legal, you understand, leeway as churchical operations, you understand, in America and throughout the world, you understand. But the real inner, the core is the spirituality. So, like, going to church on Sunday could be considered a religious thing. But now, really receiving the message and walking it out during the week, that is spirituality. So, the first thing is our private privileges. Write down private privileges are those which are for each person in his individual capacity. Secondarily, joint privileges Overstand joint privileges. Joint privileges are those which are for the whole people in its entirety and for Ethiopia in her united capacity. So when we speak about society is speaking to the individuals, but it's calling them to these joint privileges. You understand, in society and the co-laborers and the disciples, understand what role and what responsibility. So the disciple is that individual that says, I want to learn what is in my kingdom benefits. You understand, what I'm seeking the kingdom. You understand, and seeking that king man, seeking Yeshua HaMashiach in spirit and in truth. So then it further goes on to say that private and joint concepts may be of three, right? Shost, right? Or sauced, right? Sauced kinds. Three kinds. The Trinity again, right? One, the interest of livelihood. Firstly, the first thing is the interest of livelihood. What does that mean? It means worldly goods, right? Now, see for the biblical, see the scripture, the Torah, see Deuteronomy chapter 8, verse 18. Let's see if we can, hold on for a moment. Let's see if we can go here to Deuteronomy chapter 8, verse 18. And we're in Devarim. And Devarim means these are the words. These are the words, right? These are the words. So we can turn to Deuteronomy chapter 8. Verse 18, it says, but thou shalt remember the Lord thy God, or in the Hebrew, Yahweh Elohim, or in Rastafari Revelation, the King of Kings, he who be who he be. He is manifested in the person of the King of Kings, thy God, and Elohim, right? It says Eli, Eli. They thought it was Elijah, but actually it is Eliyahu or Eliah, which is highlight my power, my God. But in Revelation, we say Abba, Abba. So the King of Kings, our Father. So when we say Lord of Lords, our God, in the Revelation, it's the King of Kings, our Father. For it is he that giveth thee, that giveth the I and all of I and I the power or the ability, when we check it in the Revised Amharic Bible, Shilota, the ability to get wealth. To get money, to get wealth, that he may establish his covenant, his kalkidan, which he swear to thy fathers, to I and I fathers, to the fathers and the forefathers in this movement, and the forefathers in I and I covenant, and the Beit Israel forefathers, as it is this day. So say this day, today. Today, if you will hear his voice, harden not your hearts, as they did in the transgression, the trespass. So firstly, in the blessing now, is the interest of livelihood, which is worldly goods or the material goods, right? Secondarily, the second huletenia is the interest of the mind. What's that? That's knowledge. Mm-hmm. If you go to His Majesty's autobiography, page 192, book 1, you'll see it there, right? So secondarily is the interest of the mind, knowledge. Thirdly is the interest of the inner life. What's that? Love and religion, or fikr and the haymanot. Fikr and the haymanot. Now, the writer here says, and His Majesty is actually quoting one who was speaking about the Constitution, right? Who was speaking about the Constitution. It's a very interesting section right here. I think this is what came from the Minister of Finance, Bejaron Tekla Hawariat. He addressed them and he explained in the following discourse. So this is a discourse from Bejaron Tekla Haymanot, on whom be blessed memory. And he says right here, continuing, so the third is the interest of the inner life, love and religion. So he says, Emperor Haile Selassie first has given laws as regard the general judicial concepts for all these interests, private as well as communal, which have been referred to. But for matters of detail, he has set up what is called a constitution as a basis for the establishment of government. This is what we really have in the Ethiopian World Federation Constitution, but we have to deal with first thing, the prerequisites, the preamble. First things first, right? For the establishment, the basis of government or kingdom, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, which is our Lord and Savior, Getachin Nam and Hanatachin Jesus Christos, so that the counselors, right, the advisors, should submit to him, as we have shown above, the legislative proposals they have prepared in Parliament, the Parlama. Up to now, I have spoken in order to expound what a constitution is and also how the determination of laws is to be done. I shall now explain, they go further to explain in detail the answer to the questions I have presented to you before. And it's a very, very important read here. And we're not going to go into details, but we advise any and all who seriously want to understand the context of the UCC to refer to the autobiography of His Imperial Majesty, our Father. Now, so that was just to explain kind of the idea of the constitution of the law, the Higa Mengisht, and the Shofetim reasoning, that number 48, which was able to record, and we give thanks to those in attendance and to Wyndham Ras. Wyndham Ras Tobia Teferi for his helping to spearhead that, and all those in attendance and all those who have heard and been blessed by the King of Kings and His Christ through that reasoning and through that teaching. The Shofetim, I think it's very, this is not all accidental. We right now, we're going through a whole YouTube thing with our channel and haters and troublemakers and agent provocateurs, but this crisis is also an opportunity. Mm-hmm. And we have the means, and we should have the motive of the Holy Spirit, right? And this is the opportunity. Now, the unit, the basic unit is three. But when it squares, right, or when it's like two triangles, it becomes as a fourth, and the fourth is the treasurer. You know what I'm saying, the treasurer, the squared. This is why the cross and the faith is so very important now that when money comes into that matter. And there are special counsel and advice for treasurers. And those who are fellowshipping with I and I, link with I and I on that particular matter. It's very important, but much of it is contained within our divine heritage, within the Metz of Kedus, especially within the Metz of Kedus, which lays out the basic groundation and foundation for how to go about these things, the basic reminders, the proverbs, the wise words, the things that individually we must recognize and we must check ourselves, to take the beam out of our own eyes so we can clearly see, to take the speck out of I and I brothers' or sisters' eyes. All right, so the basic unit is the three. So we're going to deal with the ideal, and then there's special considerations for the squaring, you understand, when it becomes square. You understand, really, 360, the square and the circle is first. But first we have to square the circle, you understand. But anyway, that being as it is, there are seven basic operational responsibilities. The first is disciples, then it's a member. Then our units, you understand? The units combine also to form bands. And then there's officers, ambassadors, ministers of the Society of His Imperial Majesty, otherwise known as the Line of Judah Society, and the sister and imperial organizations, HIM organization, the Rastafari organization. This is not limited to just the Society of His Imperial Majesty. These are basic principles. You know, saying go put them to the logical test and prove them. All right. So the first thing now in a meeting, because one will say, well, how does a meeting operate? And we will hopefully attend and sit in on meetings, and ones can have I and I or one of Ionine brothers or sisters sit in, and hopefully ones can, help to give some counsel, advice that ones can pray on, and always pray on, head rest with Abba in the name of Gita Yesus, to be convicted or persuaded of what they're hearing, and study the scripture as the Bereans did. You understand? Show that nobility, studying the scripture to see whether what you hear is really what is true, and whether the Spirit affirms that which you've heard as the truth. So now, in our standing bylaws, section one, the order of business. Firstly, there's a call to order by the presiding ambassadorial angel or melach, minister of a local church or of a local church. You see, first it's the church, and then we establish the government. All good backward, but it's not really ignorance, error, you understand, and hopefully not envy. But if the envy of our enemy, over them, because they don't want us to get to this particular level. But the first thing that will go on in the meeting would be that the chair, or whoever is chairing that meeting, would call it to order. That's the presiding ambassadorial angel. Now, if you study in the scripture, look up ambassador, you see how we are ambassadors, and it fully discloses that there. But if a teaching is necessary, hopefully I or one of the brothers or sisters could provide that further information. But always one can go to the Father, to Abba, in the name of Gita Yesus, and ask, and doubt not, doubt nothing. You understand? When we ask this, ask for wisdom, but don't be double-minded. Now, the call to order basically would be, for example, if this is a meeting, you say this meeting is called to order. Now, the secretariat or the recorder, upon hearing that, would basically affirm that, would basically checks and balances, would check that. You know, since so there's the ma'at, there's the balance. Has the meeting been called to order? Which is one way that it can be checked. Yes, the meeting has been called to order. And then the secretary would say something to the effect of, this meeting is called to order at, and to write down the time. Then to ask the chair, how long is this meeting scheduled for? To find that first thing out, how long is this meeting scheduled for? Now, the meeting could be scheduled for 50 minutes. But in the course of things, it could go on longer. There could be certain presentations that have to, or for whatever reason, might have to go on longer. The secretary should keep a track of the time. And as the time gets to that time, in 15 minutes or half an hour, because there's also a list of what are the items to be discussed. Mm-hmm. After getting a time check, it's what's the items to be discussed. What are the items to be discussed in this meeting? And these would be listed, and if any from the membership or those in attendance, they would say through the chair, if it's speaking to the rest of those gathered, or to the chair. So either through the chair, that means through the chairperson, so the chairperson will acknowledge, the member is acknowledged, and then that person will say what they have to say. You understand? To the chair or through the chair. And then the basic notes of it will be taken down. Now, even though the meetings will be recorded, basic notes and a notebook for the secretary for the meetings that will be devoted to that should be there. So that should any of the other society houses or any of the administrative branches or organs would need to see that for whatever reason, a copy of it can be made, it can be scanned, so forth and so on, or retyped out. You understand? So don't worry about one's, spelling, as long as you can read it and hopefully someone else. But try to type it out as well. But handwritten notes are always the bless and the best, because you just write down different things and what's put together, and you can listen to the to the minutes, and those things can maybe provide as transcripts as well. Depends on the skills of the secretary, and we should work with what we have in spirit and in faith, and also to support ones in growing in their respective office or skills. So once the time check and the items are addressed, then the invocation is the second matter. The invocation is the second matter. Now, some might actually postpone that to the sixth matter, or the fourth matter. And it's best after the call to order that be worked out. You understand? You know, a basic sketch, a basic draft. How long the meeting is scheduled for? What are the items to be discussed? Then the invocation. Now, the invocation usually in other organization, more governmental organization, as opposed to churchical, that might be done by a chaplain. One thing we found out and was revealed to us is the barakat, the blessing, right? The blessings from Deuteronomy chapter 28, verses 1 to verse 14 is good. It's a good reminder. It's a good blessing. The chair can read that and should most likely read that, especially starting out. As we are starting out, should read that and should pronounce that blessing. You know, saying an invocation, which is basically, you know, bringing the meeting to good order in the spirit of prayer, what His Majesty says to basically close them with prayer. And the prayer should be directed to Abba, to the Father, you know, saying in the name of the Son, in the name of Gitachina, Met Hanatachin, Jesus Christos, Adonai Yeshua, HaMoshiach. Now, thirdly, is the call of the bands, the officers, the ministers, like whoever's in attendance or is expected to be in attendance. This will be done by the secretary. The secretary basically, you know, is the one in charge of, say, the moving it forward. After the invocation, an invocation is done. There can be a confirmation, affirmation, or something can be said, you know, among different, you know, groups, you know. You know, the spirit of God, of Jah, will guide them, hopefully. You understand? But point is sometimes, you know, iron sharpens iron. So the call of the bands or the disciples, if it's the call of disciples, you can basically refer to the first page, the attention, the disciples, members, units, bands, officers, ambassadors. And ministers, ambassadors, and ministers. We'll explain that to really explain what the structure is, and the groundation is really in the scriptures. So we're not trying to lay any other foundation, but the one foundation, the sure foundation. Now, the fourth thing will be the remark by the presiding Melech, the angel. Now, when I say the angel, we're not talking about the other angels who are our ministering angels, the spiritual ministering angels, Yehovah's, the good hyperdimensional beings, which are the angels of the of our Godfather and of His Christ, and they are to minister to we who are heirs of salvation, as Hebrews, our Kedase, our liturgy says. We were speaking about in the sense of revelation, there was an angel of the church. Someday there was an angel over the church, like a spiritual angel. You understand? But there was an angel over that church, but there was also the one who was the angel or those who represented that church. So in the resurrection, you understand? In the redemption, in the regeneration, rather, the correct word is the regeneration, we are as angels of God. So we are as servants, as Christ came as an angel. He was not an angel as some who have a poor theology believe he came as an angel, though he be son and lord of all. So we're learning sonship and daughtership also in that responsibility, responding and having the ability to respond. So the remarks by the presiding angel, who we might call the chairperson, right, on a committee level, you know what I'm saying, of a committee level of operation, or the minister, who was tasked with that and accepted in good faith that task. There'll be remarks, whatever remarks. They should be, you know, concise, but in keeping with what's on the items for the meeting and what needs to be remarked, right? Fifthly is the reading of minutes of previous meeting. And then we have in parentheses press release. Because different committees should have a press release to keep the public and those of that church, of that community, of that group, or even more nationally, locally, nationally, internationally informed of what is going on, if it is not a black ops, in other words, a black operation. For example, certain things that go on within the church that is part of that church community. You know what I'm saying? Perhaps we're not, like, if one is confessing to I some things they've gone through and they're seeking to be strengthened, unless they give permission, It's not for me to go and tell you what this person or that person did. That's what we mean by a black ops on that level. There are other levels of it, but we're starting out at this groundation right here. So there's a reading of minutes of the previous meeting, and this will be done by the secretary. You understand? Or one who has been appointed from the secretariat. You understand to do so. All right? The reading of minutes of a previous meeting. Well, this is what we'll discuss, the main highlight, like the bullet point, so to speak. Then the sixth matter is unfinished business. So if there were items that could not be fully dealt with or fully resolved and is still going on, these things would be either dealt with, or if ones were appointed or charged with a certain task or willing on a certain task, what is the result of such and such? Or so and so was supposed to speak to somebody for the committee or for the group. You understand? They would basically, give us some sort of report. You understand, in word, but also to have a backup in paper. You understand, to be submitted into the record. That's at the 14th part where it says the receipts of the meeting, which is not just only the paper, but it can also be paper too. If there's money or funds or something that will go into the treasury, if there's a treasury function. But we should start out before the treasury, dealing with the basic spirit of the committee first and foremostly, to decide what are we doing, why we're having this committee, what's the duration of the committee, so forth and so on, to discuss those issues. Now the seventh matter will be communication. Communication, that means, well, we heard from so and so has written us, for example, the prisoners' projects and the prisoners write to us, certain disciples, others who have written about certain things that are needful, you understand, to be shared. You understand? Perhaps we won't read it all, but it can be like a release, and it can be shared or posted somewhere where those of that committee can get a PDF or a download of the fuller form of it. Because remember to keep time with whatever amount of time that the meeting is. Like also this, we're trying to keep time with this. We're trying to do 50 minutes, but we'll see how it works out. To do the basics of this. Now, the eighth matter is application for local membership. There might be ones who want to join that particular church or Bible study or Bible society or the particular operation that's going on at that local level. And there will be also appointments to local ministry, some particular outreach ministry. Now, when we say ministry, is basically a committee. A committee is more on the governmental level, like say in the Federation, the Ethiopian World Federation. We say ministries. Ministry is basically a Gelgelot Bamarinya, and that means a service. What service are you rendering according to the skills, the gifts that Abba has given you in and through Yeshua HaMoshiach? Now, that's the eighth matter, the application. So the secretary said we got this application or this appointment or this one who seeking to be appointed for this, so forth and so on, and those things will be discussed at that particular item, right? Ninth is a report on co-laborers. So if there's ones out there doing certain special assignments for the local church or the Bible study and, or going out there even ministering the word, co-laborers, what's their report? How are things going? Where they're at? Or we even have a brother in Africa that we still, I don't think, have formally communicated with as we would like to. And he's one of the co-laborers as well. And that's just the idea of co-laborers or units. Other units might be out there, three-man teams or three-sister brethren teams out there on special assignment, whatever the assignment may be. You understand? As well as special ministries, ministries that are not in the order of the literal order of what the church operations are, but we're in a particular day and time, so the Holy Spirit gives us the ability to update and to see it in this time. That would be like a special ministry or a ministry that has maybe a limited duration, as well as a press release to share that with others. You understand? And then should be a quarterly booklet, like a Negarit, which should be produced, at least a quarterly booklet. We can start out, maybe even have it yearly or bi-yearly, you understand? Or 3 times a year or every 3 months. Every 3 months would be good. It inspires others out there to see that we are organized and that in true Rastafari, organization can and does work. All right? The 10th item is report of standing units. So there are units which have ongoing operations, bands, and committees, and ministries. Right? There's a different get into that minutiae or nuance of that for those who are interested in that, as well as a press release for these reports of standing units. Now, the standing units could, if they are in the meeting or the call conferencing, ones can give a report there. And of course, the secretary should always ask for, you know, a written report of that to be submitted into the record, and that should be provided. There's a demerit if it's not provided in a timely fashion. I mean, even just give a summary. All right, you know, spell checking and grammatical things, you know, iron sharpens iron. We should be willing to help each other and, you know, critique each other and also be willing to receive critique in the spirit and the truth of the King of Kings and his Christ. The 11th matter would be admission of new local members. At this point, new local members can be admitted. So if there's ones in attendance on the call conferencing, the meeting could be just for that. You know what I'm saying? Where ones are scattered, you know, throughout the country. So we don't have an opportunity to meet and greet members in the spirit and in the truth, right? So it's not the flesh. It's not just about the flesh. Like, I got to see you to know you really exist. Well, you think you're talking to a machine, all machines here? You can say, this is the brothers. Introduce yourself, right? As well as establishment of local ministries. That means, in a, for example, in California, there are certain sisters who seek to establish a sisterhood gathering of, say, seven sisters. You understand? Seven sisters to reason and to fellowship, as well as establish maybe certain outreach programs. You understand? For, say, the sisters who have youth, as well as other sisters who don't have youth. Now, this is not to play one against the other, but it's for ones to be according to their kind. You know what I'm saying? And there are special instructions for each of us according to our kind or what level, where we're at the time. You know what I'm saying? This is part of organization. So the admission of local members further into this, there is... Section 6 speaks on the admission of new members or disciples officially. And we can go through that. Actually, that connects with the Shema right there, right? As well as for the establishment of local ministries, number section 5, which is the oath of the unit, band, or ministry, which is more speaking of an office. You understand, or officers, you know, who are taking certain responsibility. I'm not about to read that section 5. You can go forward to section 5. That's the admission. You understand, the admission, because we are the mission of His Majesty. We are fulfilling, redeeming the name of the King of Kings and His Christ, and fulfilling that work in Yeshua HaMashiach to the glory of Abba Kadus, Kadus. Kedus, Kedus, Abatachin. Number Asara Hulet is the good and the well-being. There should be a remark for good and well-being by the presiding chair. You know, as or perhaps and or, not and or, more and, one who's of the membership can give a good word after the presiding officer or the chair yields the floor for others to also make certain good and well-being remarks or prayers or statements within a order and a timing, of course. 13th Asara source is the fulfillment remarks. What remarks now are being fulfilled to sum up, to wrap this up, so forth and so on. That's the area for the fulfillment remarks. And others also from those gathered can make certain fulfillment remarks after the chair yields the proverbial floor. Number 14, Asara Arat is the receipts of the meeting. This means that if there's certain documentation, paperwork, you understand, monies that must be presented or offerings as well can be presented, or even pledges towards, I'm going to give this, so forth and so on. And the secretary notes that. And then during the other days of the Samint or the week, those things can be followed up on. Right? Number 15 is now the adjournment. You understand? The adjournment. Where the chair would basically say, if there's no other further comments of all matters being addressed or something to that effect, this meeting, this Sib Sabha, is adjourned, and perhaps another meeting already can be scheduled, if tentative or actually. And then at that point, after the meeting is adjourned and the secretary affirms, the scribe affirms that the meeting has been adjourned, that as well as the time for that, you understand, whatever time it is, to sum up from the first part of the invocation, there will also be a prayer. A prayer should be made, a short prayer, and there are certain prayers that are appropriate from our divine heritage to make at this particular point. So, what we wanted to do basically just go over the basic order of the business. You understand? And practice makes perfect. The basic order of business. And right now, the situation with our Ethiopian World Net on the YouTubes, because the troublemakers and the haters and the agent provocateurs, this is an opportunity for I and I to do what we have been seeking to do and been saying to many of the brothers and disciples, like hold the faith, continue to, check out the vids and grow and study. And now we have an opportunity to bring the structure and the networking in good order. You understand, in good order to gather, to gather. One thing we wanted to actually make a statement the Holy Spirit just had made to I in the earlier part. The authorization, like after the call of order by the chair and after the affirmation that the meeting has been called to order by the secretary, the timing, in other words, what date it is, what day it is, as well as a check for how long this meeting and what items, you know what I'm saying, are on the agenda. Or actually, probably before that, the authorization can be read or should be read by the secretary. And once again, the authorization is by the authority of our Black Lord and Savior, Jesus Christos, the glory of our God Father, the conquering line of the tribe of Judah, Imperial Majesty Haile Selassie I, the elect of God, King of Kings of Ethiopia, and based upon the Holy Bible, the Book of the Seven Seals, known to us as the Metzhav Kedus, and also recognized and sanctioned under international law since 1948 by Article 18 and Article 28 of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, the UDHR, this meeting has been called to order. Called to order. So in that sense of functionality, like I said, practice makes perfect, and iron sharpens iron. As long as we do this in the spirit of Christ, that's why the individual responsibility, which is the private responsibility, is very important. That's why disciple is that first, we could say, unit of the body of Christ, that first individual unit. In other words, the spirit and the soul and the body, you understand, coming into alignment, denying their ego, their way of looking at it, picking up the cross, their cross, and following, walking in the way and learning of Yeshua HaMoshiach. That is discipleship at its core. Now, there's other details, section 2, there's section 3, section 2 is the monthly reports. Section 3 is the names and addresses of all members and officers, or we could say their contact information. I think at the core, it'd be good for copies of one's governmental ID, the basic ID, whatever needs to be blacked out. You understand if there's some sensitive information, I'm not too sure. You should be also submitted. There's these checks and balances that we should also go about in receiving applications. Some of this we have done, more of it we still need to do as we come into the Ethiopian world citizen. You understand? And that is probably one of the new channels that we're going to bring online, so we can also begin to address more of what we have to do within the time that we have to do it, to redeem the time, because the days are evil, right? But we know we overcome because it is written, and we have faith. We're called, we're faithful, and we're true to the King of Kings and His Christ. Section 4 is a time and place of regular meetings. Now, this might be physical meetings in a local area where people are in the same area, or they can be call conferencings if people are on a longer distance. Just some of the basic who's who, what's what. And if one doesn't want to send a copy of their ID, that's almost like, well, either you don't trust us, so how can we trust you? You understand? Let's understand that basic principle there. Now, the Section 5 is the oath of the unit, band, ministry, office. Each elected officer, you understand? And elected, we recognize what the election is in Yeshua HaMashiach. Ambassador and/or minister must affirm the following word of ministry, which is their office, before he or she is installed, or we can say recognized. And it's repeat with the left arm upraised, making the tawahido hand or and, the index finger extended, and by laying hold of the Holy Bible with the right hand. As a footnote, a King James Bible may be used. However, the Revised Amharic Bible, the Rab of His Imperial Majesty, is preferred. But if that is not available, the King James Version of the Bible may be used. So the Bible in the right hand and the upraised left arm with the index finger extended, making the one, the Ethiopic Ahaz, or the Ethiopic numeral digital, you understand, one. So here's what will be said upon the oath of a unit or units and bands and ministry. Here's what will be said. I, one's full name, you understand, one's full name, say Amen, Amen, in his spirit and in truth. Hereby do affirm to uphold, protect, and defend our divine heritage in and through the new covenant of Christ, in his kingly character, the conquering line of the tribe of Judah, his imperial majesty, Adamawi Haile Selassie, elect of God, King of Kings of Ethiopia, through our black Lord and Savior, Jesus Christos, or Jesus Christ. I, therefore, will, in spirit and in truth, perform faithfully all the duties of my office and the ministry to the best of my ability. So help me, Jah, or Yahweh, the God of Abraham, the God of Yisahak, the God of Yaakov, El Elohe Israel, the true God of Israel. Amen. And now all who witness it, upon hearing the Amen and hearing that word, say Amen. All right? So with two or three, I gathered that word of witness. There's one thing that the Holy Spirit pointed out. After the second, the name should be said again. One should say their name. All right? And that's the same name that's on our paperwork, our documentation. You understand? No nicknames here. We don't take oaths with our nicknames. Otherwise, you want to get cut. You understand? So the Section 6 is admission of new members or disciple, which would be the first oath that we would take. Right? It begins by saying the Shema of Deuteronomy chapter 6, verses 4 to 5, along with Acts chapter 8, verse 37, to be said with In the same way, with the left arm upraised, index finger extended, and holding or laying hold on the Metz Av Kedush, the tree of life, the Holy Bible, with the right hand. First, the officiating officer or member, right, shall begin the opening of the mouth. Now remember, Romans, right, Romans, let's just get a time check right here. We are actually above the 50 mark, you know, we're saying right here, but we're going to go forward with this and just sum up right here. Let's just understand what the opening of the mouth is, you know, saying according to our divine heritage. Now, it may sound like the ancient days, ancient Egypt, but there's a reason for that, because Moses was learned in all the wisdom of Egypt, you understand, and he was mighty in word and in deed. In fact, you know what we're going to do? Let us table this for a moment and pick up on this in part two, because this will deal with the Shema. The Shema as well can be dealt with also. Alright, alright, Shalom, Rastafari. Stay tuned to the Hulatenyao Kufal.